السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، welcome to this evening which is the one of the last perhaps three nights of the month of Ramadan inshallah تبارك وتعالى. May Allah عز وجل give us the ability and the blessings of attending Laylatul Qadr. Now we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this blessed evening that Allah عز وجل would not leave us leave from this place and this gathering, but all our sins have been forgiven completely. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who will be mentioned in a gathering that is better than this gathering, and that will be united with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. Allahumma ameen. Tonight, inshallah, Azza wa Jalla, I have a different topic from what we have been speaking about. We've been discussing together the book of Ibn Hazm, rahimahullah ta'ala, Mudawat al-Nufus, the healing of the souls. Tonight, a new book, inshallah, discussing a separate topic called Az-Zuhd. Az-Zuhd wa Sifat al-Zahideen by Imam al-Muhaddith, Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Ziyad, known as Ibn al-A'rabi, rahimahullah ta'ala, who died 340 Hijri. So he died more than a millennium ago, rahmatullahi ta'ala, almost 1100 years. And he wrote this book, Az-Zuhd, which means asceticism. And Sifat al-Zahideen, the characteristics of those who live ascetic life. And what's the meaning of living an ascetic life anyway? What does it mean exactly when he says Az-Zuhd? What does it mean? So when I say the word Az-Zuhd, to you, I want to hear from you first of all. What comes to your mind whenever you hear the word Az-Zuhd? Or the word asceticism, ascetic, what comes to your mind?
Isolation.
Isolation? Yeah. So you isolate yourself, yeah. Something like that? Okay, what else?
Contentment.
Okay.
Piety.
Huh? Piety? Okay.
Simple.
How about eating meat every single day? Can you be ascetic and eating meat every single day? Jama, can you?
Sounds contradictory,
right? Can you be rich and ascetic at the same time? Or do you have to be poor to be considered ascetic?
No.
Yeah, Jama. So you don't have to be poor to be ascetic. That means you can still be millionaire and billionaire and also be ascetic, right? Is that even possible? You just said, you know, simple, isolation, contentment, and so on. So kind of like contradictory understanding of the meaning of being ascetic. Let's see what the ulama say in regard to the meaning of being someone who's being ascetic and living an ascetic life in this world. قال رحمه الله تعالى ما قيل عن الزهد. This is what the ulama said in regard to describing what zuhd is, what asceticism means. قال رحمه الله تعالى. Number one, الحسن ibn al-Basri رحمه الله, he was asked about الزهد. فقال بعضهم, some people, he asked them, he said, what do you guys say about Az-Zuhd? Just like when I ask you right now. So some of the people, they said, fil libas. Means if you want to live an ascetic life, it has to show in your dress. So wearing fancy clothes, wearing something, you know, kind of certain status, doesn't count as, they wouldn't make you one of those who live ascetic life. Some others said, qalu fil mat'am. Said, no, it's actually in the food. So it depends on what you eat. So if you eat very, very good, you know, every single day and every single night, that means that's not asceticism. You have to eat very simple kind of meals and daily basis and so on. And other people, they said many things similar to that. Just like when I asked you that question, you guys, you gave your own answer, subhanAllah. What he said, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, qala al-hasan, lastum fi shay. He says, all what you said doesn't count. That's nothing. No, this is not what zuhd is. فَقَالَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ الزَّاهِدِ الَّذِي إِذَا رَأَ أَحَدًا قَالْ هَذَا أَفْضَلُ مِنِّي. A true ascetic person is the one who, when he sees someone else, he would say, this person gotta be better than me. Which means he always see other people in a better position than he is in terms of the akhirah. So he always humbles himself. He doesn't kind of bargain with Allah Azza wa Jal in comparison to other people. No. You always see yourself less doing. You always see yourself still behind. So you never feel that you're doing enough, and you always look at other people to be in a better position than you are. That is a true zahid according to Imam al-Hasan rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Imam Abu Sa'id ibn al-A'rabi, the author of this book, in commenting on the statement of al-Hasan rahimahullah, he said, قَالَ وَهَذَا دَاخِلٌ فِي بَابِ التَّوَاضُعِ وَإِسْقَاطِ الْجَهِ. He said this comes into the subject of tawadu, which means humbleness and humility. This is when you humble yourself, when you put yourself to this level of humbleness and humility. قَالَ وَإِسْقَاطِ الْجَهِ, which means not worrying so much about your status and your name. Because some people, they live their life, all what they're doing is building their name. They want to finish school to become doctors. So whenever someone calls him brother, he says, I'm Dr. Fulan, not your brother. Or someone, he works so hard to become hafiz. So when someone says, a brother, friend says, don't forget hafiz. SubhanAllah, so we worry so much about the titles, about the status, about the position in life. So he says, rahimahullah, humbleness and humility, that you don't compare yourself with people in that fashion. Instead, you always humble yourself, you know, when it comes to dealing with other people. Qala rahimahullah ta'ala, also in the meaning of az-zuhud, he said, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Khalifa, the Umayyad Khalifa, the very famous Zahid and just ruler in the Umayyad dynasty, one time he wrote to Al-Hasan. He wrote a message to Al-Hasan. Qala idhni wa awjah. He says, I want you to give me an advice and make it brief. So give me an advice and make it brief. SubhanAllah, this whole concept of give me advice and make it brief, it's very ironic, it's very important. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda, when he wrote to one of his one of his deputies somewhere else, he says, قَالَ وَإِذَا وَعَظْتَ فَأَوْجِزْ. When you give an admonition to people, when you advise people, make sure to make it brief and short. فَإِنَّ طُولَ الْكَلَامِ يُنْسِي بَعْضُهُ بَعْضًا. Because when you talk too much, the length of speech, the later makes you forget the earlier. So if you would like to give something that's powerful, just make it brief, solid, and straight to the point with the people. قَالَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. قَالَ, so Umar ibn Abdul Aziz sent to Al-Hasan, he says, عِذْنِي وَأَوْجِزْ. I want you to give me an advice and make it very brief, meaning to the point. فقال رحمه الله فكتب عليه الحسن أما مصلحك ومصلح به على يديك الزهد في الدنيا. He says, what's going to help you fix yourself, and what you need to use with other people to fix them, which means to help other people fix their dunya and fix their life. قال الزهد في الدنيا, that they lead an ascetic life. وإنما الزهد باليقين. How can I achieve this? He said, you achieve this sense of asceticism بالyaqeen, by having solid and strong certainty. Certainty with what, Jama'ah? Can you tell me? About Allah Azza wa Jal. Certainty with what? That this dunya is what? Temporary. Certainty with the akhirah, that is what? Eternal and everlasting. Certainty with the reward that Allah promised, that is real and is coming. Certainty that the punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns against is also real and it's coming. Certainty that the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghalib, means no one can really defy the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the command of Allah azza wa jal. When you have all these certainties, then you would realize, subhanAllah, how easy it is you can overcome the difficulties and the challenges and the trials of this dunya. So he says the first thing you need to learn about zuhud to lead an ascetic life is you have to have yaqeen, certainty. Then he said, rahimahullah, wal-yaqeen bil-tafakkur. Okay, how can I get this yaqeen? I want to be certain. I want to get this certainty. How can I be certain right now? He says, bil-tafakkur. What's the meaning of bil-tafakkur? Contemplation, pondering, thinking, you know, deeply. You know, we're living in a culture now that praises what? Praises fast services. Everything is supposed to be so fast and super fast, subhanAllah. So when you go to buy something, you need to have a fast lane. You go to drive-through. You order online because you cannot stand standing in line. You need everything to come quickly. And even to the extent, because of that, we live a life that is built on social kind of activities, but virtual social activity, not real social activity. Why is that? Because of the self-promotion and the culture of individualism, we're lacking something that is crucial for the human yani existence, and that's the social life. That's why whenever we are alone, It's actually a deafening silence. People, they hate to be alone. We hate to be alone quietly. So what do we do when we're alone? We play something loud in the house. And speak from the Arab culture. I know the Arab culture. Whenever you go to the house, most Arabs, they will have the TV running on. On absolutely nothing. It's just running. Why? Because they don't want to be quiet. It's so deafening to be quiet in the house, subhanAllah. Other people, they would like to play something nice. Like what? Quran, listen to Quran. Listen to dhikr, listen to a lecture, whatever. They just don't want to be quiet. SubhanAllah, not having those moments of silence deprives you from a tafakkur, deprives you from those moments of reflection, moments of pondering and thinking. Even when you drive on the highway, some people, they take the hour they spend on the highway to get home from work, it's like hell for them. Why? Because just keep, you know, driving slowly until they get home. Other people, they take this hour a blessing. Why? Because the radio's off, CD's off, nothing playing, no phones, nothing. And they just, as they drive, they're just thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the creation of Allah azza wa jalla, about everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with. They keep thinking and pondering and reflecting. So he says, rahimahullah ta'ala, وَالزُّهْدُ يَكُونُ بِالْيَقِينَ الْيَقِينُ بِالتَّفَكُّرُ. So leading an ascetic life, you need to have certainty. Certainty of what we said, what we talked about, the Akhirah. And having that certainty, in order to develop that certainty, you have to develop that sense of tafakkur, pondering, reflecting. How can you do that? How can I do this? قال رحمه الله تعالى والتفكر بالاعتبار. التفكر, to learn the sense of tafakkur, pondering and reflecting, what do you need to do? الاعتبار. What is الاعتبار here? الاعتبار, take lessons from the things happens around you in life. Take lessons. What does that mean? You heard bad news about somebody. You learn from it. You heard good news for someone else. You learn from that, you start thinking about it. So when someone is blessed with something great, what do? You think of the ni'am of Allah he blessed you with, and you be grateful. When you think of an atrocity happened to somebody, a trial, people they go through a trial, what do? You think of what you have right now, and you take lesson from it, you heed from this. Learning from what you see around you. Learning about someone who lived such a very wealthy life and then subhanAllah, they could not even enjoy what Allah blessed them with because they died young, for example. Or at least that's how people think, that they died young. Although we know when they died when their time came up, subhanAllah. So you start having that tafakkur and that tadabbur reflection when you learn from these lessons. You see what is happening around you and you learn from that. قال رحمه الله وإذا أنت فكرت في الدنيا وإذا أنت فكرت في الدنيا لم تجدها أهلا أن تبيع بها نفسك. So if you truly think about the value of this world and the value of this dunya, it's not worth selling yourself for it. Wallah, it's not worth it. He said, وَوَجَدْتَ نَفْسَكَ أَهْلًا أَن تُكْرِهَهَا بِهَوَانِ الدُّنْيَا. And you find yourself, you know, just higher than forcing yourself to deal with the loneliness of this dunya and how cheap it is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is not worth really humiliating yourself for the worldly gain in this dunya. قال, فَإِنَّ الدُّنْيَا, because you realize, فَإِنَّ الدُّنْيَا دَارَ بَلَا. This dunya, this world, it's all bala, tests and trials, one after the other. SubhanAllah. You're barely recovering from one, and then suddenly you hit with another. By the time you realize what happened, you're hit with another. And these trials don't have to be in a negative way. It can be in a positive way. And ni'am could be trials. Ni'am, the blessings that you get could be trials. Allah will test you how grateful you're going to be about this and for this. So he says, because this dunya is just nothing but trials, difficulties, hardships. وَمَنْزِلُ قِلَّ. And this is just a time, a place of temporary life. Everything in this dunya in comparison to the akhirah is temporary and it's insignificant and very little. When you compare 60, 70 years of living this life compared to eternity, what's the ratio to that? You can't even, there's no even comparison. Absolutely nothing. And that's why on the Day of Judgment, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the people back to life, many of the mushrikeen, what would they say? قَالُوا مَا قَالُوا إِن لَبِثْنَا إِلَّا سَاعَ. We only lived an hour. Although they lived 50 and 60 and 70 years more or less, some of them had hundreds of years, like the people in the past, right? They say that we only survived, we only lived for an hour. Like it's not fair to rule and judge us right now because all we live just 1 hour. So he says, rahimahullah ta'ala here, if you truly want to see what the dunya is, if you truly look at this dunya, you realize that is nothing. It's worth nothing. Subhanallah, one time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking with a group of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So he saw a goat, a dead goat. So a corpse of a dead goat. And it used to be from Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, his wife. So he said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu, من يشتري مني هذه بدرهم? Who would like, بدينار, he said, who would like to buy this for a dinar? Dinar means gold. Like saying, for example, who wants to buy this for $500? قالوا يا رسول الله, no one will buy it for $500 or for a dinar. He said, okay, what about a dirham? How about dirham, silver? Like saying $100, for example. قالوا ولا بدرهم. And they start kind of like saying, no one will pay anything for this, ya Rasul. Even if it was alive, it doesn't even look big enough or healthy enough, you know, in its shape that is dead right now. Even if it was alive, no one would pay that much for it. He said, la dunya. He says, you see, you won't even pay that much for this. He says, the entire dunya that you live, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it worth even less than this animal to you. And that's why the ulama, they say, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ كَانَتَ الدُّنْيَا تُسَاوِي عِنْدَ اللَّهِ جَنَاحَ بَعُوضَ مَا سَقَى مِنْهَا كَافِرًا شَرْبَتَمَا. If this dunya was worth the wing of a fly or a mosquito to Allah Azza wa Jalla, if it was worth that much, He would never give in a sip of water to a disbeliever. Because they're not worshipping Allah, they're not being grateful to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why would He give Him anything? But it's because of that Allah has given it easily to them. Hopefully, that one time in their lives, they would heed and they would reflect, return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah to make us among those who always, always return back to Allah azza wa jal on regular basis in repentance to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال رحمه الله تعالى لسفيان الثوري, he says, قالوا للزهري, ما الزهد? So Imam al-Zuhri رحمه الله was asked, what is asceticism? قال, من لم يغلب الحرام صبرا. من لم يغلب الحرام صبرا. ولم يمنع الحلال شكرا. What does that exactly mean? It says, someone who's ascetic is the one who's al-haram never overcomes his patience. And al-halal never overcomes his gratitude. So what does that mean? That means whether you're by yourself, around the people, in public, in private, wherever you are, wherever you are, al-haram does not overcome your patience. Because when you ask people who commit sins, jama'ah, what did they commit sins for? They couldn't resist. You ask them, what did you do that for? He says, well, I got weak. Say, I got weak. Alhamdulillah, I go to the masjid, I pray the 5 daily prayers, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, I fast Ramadan, I do my best, and I even sometimes volunteer for the khair, or do this ibadah, and so on. So I do my best. But when it comes to dealing with these shahawat, these sins, I'm a human being after all, and I get weak. So when I get weak, kind of feeling, subhanAllah, kind of compelled to do it. So he said a true zahid, someone who's really, really zahid, leading an ascetic life and a pious life, is the one whose haram does not overcome his patience. And al-halal, la yamna'u shukra. And the halal that Allah blesses him with, would never stop him from being grateful. What does that exactly mean? If I tell you, think of someone who's very, 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 very wealthy. Someone who is, let me use the word, filthy rich. What comes to your mind? Anyone thought of someone praying Salat al-Isha? I doubt it. Because when we say filthy rich, we all associate wealth with what? Money and what? Mansions, cars, mischief, parties, this, that, and so on. That's how we associate that, right? So he says, Rahimahullah ta'ala, meaning whatever Allah blesses you of halal, it doesn't stop you from being grateful. That's what it means. So the true pious person, the true ascetic person is the one whose haram does not prevent them, does not actually break their patience, and the halal never breaks their gratitude. They're always grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal, and there's always patience. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who are always patient, jama'ah, and those who are always grateful to Allah Azza wa Jal. Qala rahimahu Allah ta'ala. وَسُئِلَ مَيْسَرَةَ إِبْنُ حُلَيْسٍ الْجُبْلَانِ about الزُّهْد. He said, قَالْ لَيْسَ الزَّهَارَةُ فِي الدُّنْيَا بِتَحْرِيمِ الْحَلَالِ. Because he said, being ascetic or leading an ascetic life doesn't mean to make halal haram for yourself. No, it doesn't mean that. وَقَالْ وَلَا بِإِضَاعَةِ الْمَالِ, and not to throw your money away claiming that this is charity and then start begging people. That doesn't mean to not to work or quit your job or waste your money or just throw them away because you think you shouldn't have that much money in your hand and so on. So this is not asceticism. وَلَكِنِ الزَّهَادَةُ فِي الدُّنْيَا أَن تَكُونَ بِمَا فِي يَدِ اللَّهِ أَوْثَقَ مِنْكَ بِمَا فِي يَدِكَ. Wow. He said the true meaning of being ascetic is that you have so much trust in what is there in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you than the trust that you have in that which is in your own hand. So you have so much trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what Allah has for you than what you have in your own hand. Remember when we talked about iftiqar ilallah, your sense of dependency in Allah azza wa jal, how you feel poor, you in need of Allah azza wa jal subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is it. This is what it means over here. And so when he said, laysa zahadatu fi dunya, it doesn't mean that you always yani kind of abandon the dunya if it's halal. No, that doesn't mean that this is the case. Absolutely not. Some people, they think that when it comes to being ascetic life, they come to the masjid and they don't take care of themselves very well. I remember when I used to be in Medina, students in Medina, there were some students that would irritate me, subhanAllah. They come to the salah and their thawb is not ironed. I said, why, akhi, your thawb is not ironed? Then I accept the answer, laziness. I accept that. But when someone tells me, ya akhi, subhanAllah, I don't want to waste my time, you know, ironing my thawb because I would like to spend that in ibadah. And I'm for me, are you kidding me? Ya salam. So coming to the masjid and to the haram and to the masjid Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with a shirt with your thawb that's completely yani, messed up, is that what you call zahada? What you call, you know, zuhd in the dunya? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Being ascetic, not in the thawb, like we heard from Al-Hassan, it's not in your dress, it's in the heart. So here, being zahid doesn't mean not to pursue what is halal for you. What if someone, you know, has been given an opportunity to apply for a better position in his job, or being promoted, or being given a better deal, or whatever that is. So, is it allowed? Can I do this? Absolutely. If it's halal, that's fine. But he says, and don't waste this opportunity, but you always, even as this new deal and money and rich and raise comes your way, you never think that this is what's going to make your life better. What's going to make your life better, Jama'ah? The trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. The trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you have so much trust in what that is, what's in the hand of Allah Azza wa Jal for you, than trust in what you have in your own hand. قال رحمه الله تعالى he said قال وأن يكون حالك في المصيبة. So this is now in regard to what you have. What if you've been tested? What if you've been put in such a very difficult test and hardship? Something that breaks you. You feel overwhelmed. SubhanAllah. What do you do in this case? قال وأن يكون حالك في المصيبة وحالك إذا لم تصب بها سواء. Says, and you, during time of hardship and time of ease, you are the same. Can you guys be at that level? Is it even possible? Imagine someone has been blessed, mashallah, all these years. Allah blessed you with a great job, alhamdulillah, great salary, great life, great family, great experience, all of this, and alhamdulillah, everything was going smooth and was so beautiful. And then suddenly you were tested. How fast would you change? Towards Allah Azza wa Jal, first and foremost. How fast would you change? Would you still be connected to Allah Azza wa Jal and being grateful to Him at times of difficulty as much as you are at time of ease? So that is what it means over here. He says, وَإِنْ يَكُونَ حَالُكَ فِي الْمُصِيبَةِ, when you've been tested and tried, equal to when you don't have any of that trouble or any of that trials. وَأَنْ يَكُونَ ذَامُكَ وَمَادُحُكَ فِي الْحَقِّ سَوَاءٍ, and to you, whoever praises you or criticizes you, as long as it's true, they're both equal to you. As human beings, we don't like criticism, right? But what do we love to hear? Praise. We love praise even if it's not true about us. So if someone comes to you and says, MashaAllah, you are Imam al-Mu'mineen, Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are the best person, you know, on earth, you are this, you are that, you're this. And we love it, right? Even if we know that it's not true, we don't seem to resist listening to it and feeling good about it. To the extent that we're not even willing to challenge it, like saying, Astaghfirullah, Audhu Billah, that's not me, what are you talking about? Why? Because it sounds beautiful in the ear. When someone tells you, MashaAllah, where did this knowledge come from? Allahu Akbar, look at you, MashaAllah. SubhanAllah, when you hear these things, it's very tempting. But when someone criticizes you, even that thing is real about you, you don't like it. Like saying, you know, listen, you know what, you're lazy. Me? No, you're lazy. But Yahi, you're truly lazy. I mean, come on, when you come to the shoe racks over here and you put your shoes right 1 foot away from the shoe racks, you don't even pull them up on the shelves. That is absolutely laziness and selfishness. SubhanAllah. Don't tell me you're not. So SubhanAllah, so we hate it though. We hate to be criticized in that which we have. So he says, a true Zahid, someone who's truly have that zuhd and ascetic life, he wouldn't mind, you know, being criticized or being praised if it was haqq and true. Because praise would not change your intentions. And criticism would not also change intention either. They're always, alhamdulillah, pure. قال رحمه الله تعالى في معنى الزهد. الزهد في الدنيا, to lead an ascetic life in this world. ألا تأسى على ما فاتك منها, that you never experience or have any grief or sorrow for what you missed. وَلَا تَفْرَحْ بِمَا أَتَاكَ مِنْهَا, and don't be over excited or over happy, you know, overjoyed by what comes to you from this dunya. You know, some of us today, as we start growing, you know, older and older, we miss a lot of opportunities in life. As you reach my age and perhaps be older, you start looking back, knowing that there isn't much left for you to live than what you already lived, right? So what do you do now? Start thinking, you know, I wish I've done this. I wish I've done that. Man, I wish that I got this. I missed this one. I missed the opportunity. You start kind of crying for what you missed. He says, this is not zuhd in the dunya. If you're truly ascetic about this dunya, whatever you missed, alhamdulillah. Because, you know, it wasn't written for you. It wasn't written for you. Khalas. You need to move on. And what's coming next is not in your hand either. So you don't worry about it. You don't overjoy, you know, don't have that kind of over excitement about what's coming to you, because you know that is not permanent. It's temporary. So you always balance what you have in this dunya between, you know, the kind of like not missing anything from the past and not getting over excited about what you get, you know, in the dunya. قال رحمه الله تعالى في معنى الزهد, to have this ascetic life, he said رحمه الله الزهد في الدنيا, to have an ascetic life, قال قصر الأمل, قصر الأمل. What does قصر الأمل mean? Means having short hope in this world. What does that exactly mean? نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says in another hadith, قال يكبر ابن آدم وتكبر معه خصلتان. The son of Adam will grow old, and two things will always grow with him, which means they never stop growing. What are these two things? قال حب الدنيا وطول الأمل. The love for this world, طول الأمل, which means having hope for a long life. You always want to live more, and also what you have in the ownership of the dunya. You know, if you have mashallah an elderly in the community in your life, in your household, if you have, let's say, great grandfather, great grandmother, mashallah, you know, subhanallah, their life revolves around whatever is left for them of possessions in this world. I remember my grandfather, my grandmother, she has value for the plastic bags that she has in her drawers. Her metal cup, the spoon that she uses, always has to be there. Her prayer rug, her tasbih. So all these things, most valuable to her. If they're missing, if they're not in the place where she used to it, it just be a big deal. Where is it? What happened to it? Subhanallah. And she feels so bad when she misses these things. I remember my grandfather, and mashallah, he lived until he passed, actually 80 plus years. I remember we visited him in Palestine. We were kids. And he was in his 70s at that time. So the most valuable thing for him, a man who grew old, working on his land. He was taking care of the fig trees and the olive trees and so on, subhanAllah. So in our village, in our land, we had one of the oldest fig trees in the entire area. Huge. It's huge, actually. It takes few people, you know, hold their arms to surround it. And it was kind of tall. But because it's very old, it's extremely, extremely old, it stopped producing fig. But it was big and huge. So one time, I remember my brother and my cousin, they were teenagers at that time, maybe 14, 15 years old. So they climbed up the tree and they sat on one of those long branches that's extending from the tree out. Subhanallah, as they were playing and they're kind of bouncing it off, the whole branch broke off and fell on the ground while they're riding on it. And they fell on the ground. My grandfather came running. You know why? To beat them up. Subhanallah, wallahi, I remember my grandfather at 70 years old. He stood there crying. Crying for that branch. Like, wow. I mean, why did you break it? Why did you do that for? He didn't care about the kids if they broke a leg or head or nothing. He didn't care about that. He says, because they're young, they're going to survive it and they're going to move on. But he started crying for that branch. Subhanallah, I mean, his dunya was revolving around it. So these are the most valuable things for him. And sometimes that's what hurts us the most. What hurts us the most really is when something is extremely, extremely valuable to you, And you feel that it's kind of like you're losing it, you lost it. That's, subhanAllah, attachment to this dunya. So for a person to have an ascetic life, you need to upgrade your concerns instead of making them dunya, to make them into the akhirah. So whatever happens in the dunya, you're going to always be at ease because you have so much trust in that which is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than that which is in your hand. You always have that. But whatever happens to you in the dunya, have trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. Maybe there's a hikmah behind, a wisdom. And sometimes we go through trials and fitan. Wallahi, we can't even explain. You don't even know. But Allah Azza wa Jal tests His ibad in the way that just kind of unbelievable. You can't even think of everything basically and get the wisdom from it. So what do you do in this case? You just ask Allah Azza to give you that patience and ask Allah to give you that fahm and understanding. Yani Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised two anbiya, a father and son. He praised them for ilm and for understanding. Do you guys know these anbiya? Who are they? Who was that the alim, who was that the prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised for knowledge? Dawood alayhi salam. And who was the prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised for his understanding of knowledge? Sulaiman. Sometimes Allah gives you knowledge. You only become a carrier of that knowledge. The understanding of it is to someone else. That's what the Prophet ﷺ says. بَلِّهُ عَنِّي وَلَهُ آيَةٌ. Just deliver the message. رُبَّ مُبَلَّغٍ أَوْعَى مِنْ سَامِعٍ. Perhaps you will deliver it to someone who hears from you and he will comprehend better than you. وَرُبَّ حَامِلُ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهٍ. Perhaps you carry that knowledge and you have no understanding of it. وَرُبَّ حَامِلُ فِقْهٍ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَفْقَهُ مِنْ. And perhaps you have an understanding that you carry to someone who has better understanding than you. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to give us that ilm and that knowledge. And we ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to provide us with that understanding of that knowledge. And we ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to give us the ability to see through all these events in our life. And we ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to give us the best understanding of Allah's hikmah and Allah's wisdom. We ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to give us that ilm that is beneficial to us. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to help us benefit from the ilm that we learn. We ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to give us the beautiful understanding of that ilm and that knowledge. We ask Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala to help us, Ya Rabbil Alameen, to fill our heart with hikmah and with wisdom. We ask Ya Allah to forgive us our sin in this evening. We ask Ya Rabbil Alameen to make us among those who would witness Laylatul Qadr, Ya Rabbil Alameen. We ask Ya Allah to purify our hearts. We ask Ya Allah to purify our heart. Ya Allah, purify our hearts from the evil of ourselves and our evil deeds. Ya Allah, we ask you to purify our heart from the envy. We ask you, Allah, to purify our hearts from al-hasad wal-hiqd, Ya Rabbil Alameen. We ask you, Allah, to remove any form of grudge or hatred to anyone, Ya Rabbil Alameen, of the believers from our hearts. We ask you, Allah, to fill our hearts with the love of the believers and love of Allah and love of the Messenger of Allah and love of the Deen of Allah, Azza wa Jal. We ask you, Allah, to guide our heart to that which is best and that which pleases you, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And we ask you, Allah, to make our hearts stay away from that which displeases you, Ya Rabbil Alameen. We ask you, Allah, to give us the satisfaction in this dunya and al-rida and al-qana'a and contentment for what you decree for us, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And we ask you, Allah, that if you test us and you try us, Ya Rabbil Alameen, to make it easy and simple on us and to make it very, very, very easy on us to understand and to endure, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And we ask you, Allah, Ya Rabbil Alameen, to relieve us and alleviate our sufferings in this dunya and the akhirah. And we ask you, Ya Rabbil Alameen, to fill our hearts, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, with the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the love for being with him in Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So we have a few minutes, inshallah, 15 minutes, bin Allah, for question, bin Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. Any question? Yes?
If you can explain the difference between
the
and the good book.
So the question is, what's the difference between tafakkur and tadabbur? There are many words in the Quran that are mentioned, actually. Al-fahim, al-tadabbur, al-tafakkur, al-ta'ammul, and so forth. Where is it coming from? Each one of them has its own meaning. Profound meaning. They all mean pondering, reflecting, and kind of contemplating. But there is a profound meaning for each one of them. So at-tadabbur basically comes from ad-dubur, which basically when you think of something, but what you do, you come all the way to the end of it. Dubur shay, the end of it. So when you think of something, you don't just stop at the surface. No, you try to go deep to the end of the matter to understand it. That's the meaning of at-tadabbur. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Quran. He didn't say, أَفَلَا يَتَفَكَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. He didn't say that you use al-fikr to understand the Quran. No, he says what? Tadabbur. So you use basically all your senses and to come to the end of the matter to understand the Quran deeply. At-tafakkur is a little bit different. Al-fikr, when you have to al-fikr, it basically comes to rationalizing and try to understand the wisdom. And sometimes it's just the surface of it. So it's separate from a tadabbur. Tadabbur understand the whole thing. Al-tafakkur, each fikra, is perhaps a separate than the other one. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Now. Yes?
So, one question about, when we think for example, if someone has $10,000 on his account, and now it's okay, every month he's earned more money, but he thinks, okay, now I'm trusting on Allah means I just spend all that $10,000 towards, giving to Allah. Or some charity, and I'll just trust on Allah for it. Mm-hmm. Or this is a trust, or trust is like you still trust on Allah, but you keep that money just for the thinking of, I may have been in trouble, I lose my job or something, so I can survive for next couple of months.
Mm-hmm.
So is there something wrong when you feel like that?
So is it okay even in the first place for someone who has a certain amount of money, let's say someone has $10,000, says, you know what, I'm going to give everything for the sake of Allah to build the masjid, inshallah, and I'll put my trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. And that's it. Is that good, Jama'ah? Now, I would say if you have a business plan, then that's okay. Which means if you have a job that mashallah gives you enough, and $10,000, you don't worry about it because alhamdulillah I keep my job, bidnillahi ta'ala, that's fine. But someone who just got laid off, he doesn't have saving in his bank, no business plan, and he had this emotional, spiritual moment of trusting Allah on everything and his affairs in his life, so he threw all his $10,000 into building the masjid because Allah promised Allah will give you back. So therefore he says, that's it, Allah will give me back. That's it. If this is the case, that's very troubling, right? You can't do this. You have to have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is true. But at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be reasonable in what you do. Like in the story of the man who came to the masjid and he wanted to tie his camel. He said, Ya Rasulullah, a'quluha wa tawakkal, amma tawakkal ala Allah. Shall I tie the camel down first and then trust Allah azza wa jalla, or should I just trust Allah and go and get into the masjid? The Prophet says, no, i'qilha wa tawakkal. You tie your camel down first and then you can trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I would say anyone without any business plan shouldn't be making that move. Some of us might start, you know, using the evidences that we have from the seerah. Like, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did it, ya akhi. Ya akhi, are you like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq? If you have one fraction of his iman and his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I'll give you that. We're not even close to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. We're not even close to his cleverness, radiallahu anhu, of being a great merchant, a great businessman, radiallahu anhu. And then we start, you know, making these as an example. Worse than that. Some people, they claim that trusting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means that you do absolutely nothing in this dunya and wait, inshallah, for the gold star raining in on top of you. That's what you do. And they bring you all these stories about this imam and qutb and salih and great alim and great this and great that. They put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, provide for them. Ya akhi, if you are at that level of iman, then they will talk about it. So don't take this as now as your ideals. I want you to take Rasulullah as your example. I want you to take the ulama, the Sahaba as your example. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they gave, but they worked hard. They gave and they kept something for themselves. So don't tell me these people who do everything like this becomes actually a model. No. There is no better model than the model of Rasulullah and his companions radiallahu anhum jami'an. Wallahu anhum. Sisters, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. We have any question? Go ahead.
Living in the Bible, is that to be absurd?
Huh?
Is it compared to living in the life of the Sufi, meaning spending a lot of time in the diet, not like the Sufi?
Well, I mean, some people basically they hold on to certain titles. They associate Sufism with Zuhud. Honestly, I have seen a lot of people who claim to be on the Sufi path, but they don't show the signs of Zuhud. And I've seen other people who don't associate themselves with these titles, but they have the signs of Zuhud. So when it comes to Zuhud, it has nothing to do with any specific label, any specific ideology, any specific group, and so on. People can claim whatever they want to claim. But the Zuhud is in the heart more actually than anything else. And that's what Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala and Imam Ghazali rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi, speaking about Zuhad, he gave different examples. He said the ulama, when it comes to Zuhud, they have different capacities. Ulama, they had different capacities. Some people, they were able to sacrifice so much. Like Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, as an example. Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, one of the greatest Zuhad. And when he was in prison, he was tortured so much so that when he was released, in a compensation from the state, Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, ta'ala, the Khalifa brought him treasures. Treasures of gold and money, just say, I'm sorry, we're sorry for the trouble. The moment the treasures got into the house of Imam Ahmad freaked out. He told his son, take it away and spend it right now. Right now. He said, قَالَ وَاللَّهِ This is a greater fitna than the fitna I was suffering and going through before. Because the one when I was in prison, I had to endure the pain, right? Now that I have all this ni'mah, he says, I'm afraid this ni'mah is going to ruin my intention. So therefore, he says, take it away. But that's Imam Ahmad, rahmatullah alayh. Imam Malik, on the other hand, he says, was different. Imam Malik, he started his life very poor, extremely, extremely poor. They said he had to even sell the roof of his house, the beams of the roof of his house, in order to get some money and buy some food. He had to do that, rahimahullah. But by the end of his life, when he has a trial with the Khalifa, the governor of Medina, and the Khalifa tried to kind of make it up for him and compensate for him, he was spending so much on him, gave him allowance, basically like treasure for Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. So they said about him, he lived a very comfortable life. He used to eat meat every single day, dresses nicely, he had even cushions at home, so he had a nice, comfortable life towards the end of his life, rahimahullah. When he was asked about it, he said, this is because it's coming from the Khalifa. If it was coming from anybody else, I wouldn't have accepted. So for him, taking it from the Khalifa, which is the head of the state, yani, is something unique and special. So he said, I will have to take it. If it was from anybody else, I wouldn't have taken that. Besides, he said, I want to ataqawwa, I want to get stronger so I can stand out for the people and go out and teach the people. He said, for me, my body, I need sustenance. So he took care of it. He needed to be comfortable so he could go out and teach the people. So when it comes to zuhud, people come in different capacities. I've seen very wealthy people, mashallah, but wallahi, their hearts are just the hearts of those who are not attached to this dunya at all. And everything that they own it in their hand, not in their hearts. And I've seen some poor people, subhanAllah, the little that they have is occupying so much space in their hearts, and it's controlling even their mind. And it's little. So when it's come to zuhud, it has nothing to do with being in a certain label, certain path, as much as how you have it in your heart. Wallahu a'lam. Nah. Yes?
So zuhud, is it something you train, or is it from birth, or how do you...
Very good question. Are you born with it, or do you have to train yourself to become zahid, or to become someone who's ascetic? What do you guys think? It's exercise. It's exercise. You know, somehow it's very ironic, because sometimes people are born in a worthy family, but they hate that kind of lifestyle. They hate it. I've seen so many people like this. They live so wealthy, but subhanAllah, what they see around them, it makes them kind of feel, you know, kind of awkward. So they don't want to keep this in their hands. So they kind of separate themselves from their families in that sense. Is that right? No, you don't have to do that. You don't have to, like we heard about the zuhud, you don't have to throw the money away just to become zahid. Not at all. You don't have to. Instead, you need to just exercise to put yourself in a position to learn how to balance things, inshallah, tabarakah wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam. Sisters, any question? Khair, inshallah, ta'ala. We have Ibn al-Azal tonight. We have Qari, brother Khurram Khurshid. Qureshi, I mean. Khurram, actually. Qureshi and brother Asim.